Thank you, Marcus, for the kind introduction. And thank you, Professor Bronco, for the kind invitation here in Vicenza. So, several recent studies clearly demonstrated that AKI is an inflammatory disease. Following a renal injury, we have a systemic inflammatory response and a simultaneous compensatory anti-inflammatory response. And as shown by the PICAR study, plasma cytokine levels may predict mortality. At the gene level, we can find some polymorphism, in particular TNF-alpha, identifying patients more prone to develop AKI and worse outcome. In particular, the high producer of TNF-alpha are associated with a worse outcome and the development of AKI. And if you look to tubular cells, they may contribute to this inflammatory state. Indeed, the tubular cells are the main target of renal injury during AKI. Ischemia reperfusion, nephrotoxic insults or sepsis lead to loss of polarity of tubular cells. Cells that, in particular for apoptosis, the slime of viable and dead cells with luminal obstruction, the formation of this area of denudation of the basal membrane, the back leakage of tubular fluid, and inflammation. But tubular cells are multitasking cells that are involved in several aspects of renal physiology, including the reabsorption of ions, proteins, but also the secretion of growth factors, regeneration factors, and may have a role as clearance of inflammatory mediators, complement, and cytokines. And looking at the crossover between inflammation and tubular epithelial cells, I remember these study published by Claudio Ronco looking at entropy in a biological system. Entropy describes the level of disordered amount of thermal energy in a system, and according to the second law of thermodynamics, biological reactions are accompanied by a decrease in free energy. So in normal life, we have low levels of entropy, but in presence of diseases such as cancer and uremia, including AKI, we have an increase of this entropy. And the better description of the increase of entropy is systemic inflammation and multiple organ failure. We know that inflammatory mediators may lead to multiple organ failure, but also that the failure of different organs may lead to an increase of the release of inflammatory mediators. But if you look some further insight in the crosstalk between this inflammation and the kidney, in particular tubular cells, so we have to move, in my opinion, from entropy to another term from the physics, that is the entanglement. Entanglement is a physical phenomenon that occurs when pairs or group of particles are generated or interact in ways such that the quantum particle cannot be described independently. It was described by Schrödinger as something that cannot be separated. So inflammation, sepsis, and AKI is something that cannot be separated. And entanglement is present in nature. This is some example of the entanglement in animals and some strange in humans. But looking at the entanglement of sepsis and AKI, we have to follow two pathways. So the first is how inflammation may lead to tubular injury, and so the sepsis as the cause of AKI, but sepsis as the systemic inflammation as the consequence of renal damage. If you look at the first pathway, we can see that inflammatory mediators may lead to several alterations of tubular cells, inducing leukocyte adhesion, mitochondrial dysfunction, loss of polarity, and necroapoptosis. Then, Leonardo Bellomo just showed us why GFR decrease in sepsis is not only due to renal hypoperfusion, because there is a dissociation between renal blood from. And this may also suggest the presence of a mechanism that is in nature more toxic or immunological. So we have some damage-associated molecular patterns, so-called DAMs, or pathogen-associated molecular PAMs, that may lead to alteration of the immune cells and also of cells resident in the organ, including the kidney. As shown by John Kellum in the session this morning, PAMs and DAMs may be freely filtered by your memory, in which the luminal part of tubular cells, but this inflammatory mediator may also reach capillaries, altering endothelial cells, and inducing a detrimental crosstalk between endothelial and tubular cells of the basal vessels. This was in accordance with our previous study showing that without any kind of hyperperfusion, only putting the plasma of a septic patient with AKI on a human tubular epithelial cells in the lab, we observed an increase of apoptosis. This is DNA fragmentation typical. The induction of cascades and fast expression. And the apoptotic rate was associated with the low molecular weight proteinuria observed in septic patients with AKI and with other parameters of tubular function, such as fractional expression and solubility. And there are other studies showing the importance of apoptosis in the kidney, is the early postmortem autopsy. In the presence of DNA fragmentation and cascade activation in tuberous cells, so the presence of apoptosis. And apoptosis is a key factor not only in the kidney. From some data from Hotchkiss group revealed that lymphocyte decrease in septic patients associated with immunoparalysis was mainly due to apoptosis. So in gram-negative sepsis, this mechanism of RMAT damage in fully elucidated is LPS and the toxic activate toll-like receptor 4, TLR4, on the tubular cells, so a direct injury pathway, but we may also have a systemic injury pathway because TLR4 in other cells may be activated, leading to the release of several inflammatory mediators. And these mediators are in particular able to activate the death receptor pathway in tubular cells. So these mediators are TNF-alpha, FAS ligand, CD40 ligand that can interact with membrane surface receptor present on tubular cells, activating caspase 8 and apoptosis. But we clearly demonstrated the role of mitochondrial alteration. So we have the mitochondrial pathway of apoptosis leading to the release of cytokine C from mitochondria to the cytosol, activation of caspase 9 and apoptosis. So apoptosis is the first important alteration of tubular cells associated with inflammation. The second one is mitochondrial alteration can but not lead to the release of cytochrome C. We can also define it as mitochondrial dysfunction. This is an interesting paper in which it has been shown that inflammatory mediators may reduce renal oxygen alteration of mitochondrial function. In particular, the decrease of this protein called PGC1-alpha, that is one of the main mediators of mitochondrial biogenesis, and is suppressed in presence of inflammation. The reestablishment of PGC1-alpha normal levels in tubular cells is a key factor for normal renal regeneration in after sepsis-associated AKI. A third mechanism is the loss of cell polarity. Polarity a particular characteristic of all epithelial cells to maintain two distinct fluid filler compartments with precise electrolyte concentration. And during inflammation and sepsis, we have a significant decrease in all epithelial cells, not only in tubular cells, of these proteins present at the tight junctions, such as ZON1 and DOCLIN. And the loss of polarity may lead to some specific alteration of tubular cells in inflammation and sepsis, in particular, the downregulation of the endocytic receptor megaly in the surface of tubular cells. So we have not a normal reabsorption of proteins, and this is a characteristic of the low molecular weight proteinuria observed in septic patients. But we can also observe during sepsis and inflammatory that these inflammatory mediators may lead to the downregulation of ion glucose and urea transporters in tubular cells. And this may lead, ultimately, to an increased sodium and chloride in the tubular macular veins, so contributing to the tubular glomerular feedback and to the GFR decrease. As a last mechanism of inflammation of tubular cells, this is something associated also with the progression from AKI to CKD. The cell cycle arrest of tubular cells in the G2M phase of the cell cycle with the release of pro-fibrotic factors as elegantly demonstrated by a group of John Bovent in Boston in different experimental models of AKI. This may lead to and also the biomarker that we use, TNGAR, KIM1, TIM2, and IgF-binding protein 7, are expression of the differentiation of tubular cells and cell cycle arrest. Coming back to our entanglement, we have now to see the pathways number 2, so not as the AKI may lead to an increase of systemic inflammation. We have some epidemiologic data, again from the PICAR study, in which we can identify that sepsis is not only the cause, but also the consequence. Since many of AKI episodes, of the sepsis episode occurs after AKI diagnosis. And if you look at the cellular level, this may be explaining because after stress, the tumor epithelial cells may release several cytokines and chemicals that can bind to and activate several cells of the innate adaptive immunity. In particular, tubular epithelial cells are antigen-presenting cells expressed on stimulatory molecules such as CD40 that can activate on T cells CD40 ligand and tissue damage. And we can also have some epigenetic mechanisms leading to an increase of inflammation following AKI episodes. This epigenetic factor may influence DNA methylation and in particular histone modification. The binding of epigenetic factor to histone may tell alters the extent to which DNA is wrapped around histones, and so the availability of genes in the DNA to be activated. And in this elegant study from Richard Zager, in several and different experimental models of AKI, an increase of TNF-alpha and MSP1 levels. And this increase is due to a direct increase of the messenger RNA coding for these cytokines and chemokines, but this increase is also due to the binding activity of RNA polymerase 2 of these two mediators, but in particular to an increase of histone methylation, so epigenetic mechanism, and in particular the increase in trimethylation methylation of histone-free lysine 4. Increase of release of inflammatory mediators from tubular injury may be responsible for the so-called organ distant injury and the association of multiple organ failure with AKI. In particular, Kevin Kelly's group demonstrated the role of TNF-alpha in inducing cancer, but we have also alteration in lung, gut, liver, and the brain. So I don't know if some of you know this old gentleman. This is, we are talking about quantum physics, so this is Professor Peter Higgs, who won the Nobel Prize for the discovery of Higgs boson, the Gauss particle, that changed completely the view of the standard model of quantum physics. So the question here now is, we have something new in our standard model of sepsis-associated AKI. I think that something new may be represented by the presence of microvesicles. Microvesicles are these small particles that are released by different types of activated cells, are formed by membrane or phospholipids, with the presence of different surface receptors, but they also carry genetic information, messenger RNA and microRNA, and then can be internalized in target cells, changing their biological behavior. And we have, in the plasma, we have normally the presence of different microvesicles, in particular, derived from monocytes and platelets. And these vesicles are full of microRNAs that can be transferred. So their microvesicles represent an elegant and way of cell-to-cell communication. So our working hypothesis is that during inflammation, leukocytes and platelets may release the microvesicles that are altered in number and their RNA content. And we observed this using this instrument that is called NanoCyte that allows the determination of size and concentration of the vesicles in body fluid following Brownian motions. And you can see that in septic patients, we have of microvesicles in the plasma, in particular in septic death. The more you are sick, the increase of SOFA score, you have an increase of microvesicles in the plasma. These vesicles express different molecules that are involved in inflammation and apoptosis, such as Fas ligand and CD40 ligand, and express different microRNAs that are currently under investigation. And this was also observed in experimental models of sepsis, in which LPS injection induce an increase of plasma microvesicles. And interestingly, microvesicles are not only biomarkers of disease, because if you take the vesicles from a septic animals, you inject them in a healthy animals, you regress sepsis, and in particular sepsis-associated AKI, because these vesicles, which are stained in red, can be internalized in endothelial and tubular epithelial cells. These are an experiment performed using microvesicles from humans with sepsis and AKI, and you can observe after the infusion vascular derangement and some of the tubular alteration that I described. They induce the decline of urine volume and an increase of blood urine nitrogen. And what is interesting is that if you treat the vesicles with RNAs, that is an enzyme that can be internalized in the vesicles and destroy all the RNA steps within the vesicles, you do not have this detrimental effect. So you can transfer the disease using the RNA inside the vesicle. Very interesting. Coming my presentation, I want to propose some, at least three possibilities, or what I call the disentanglement of inflammation and AKI. So how we can stop this detrimental crosstalk. I think that one thing is that early inoculate biomarkers or septic AKI, but I want to just focus in a couple of dialogue at the potential of extracorporeal blood purification technique. This is one example, polymixing DNA perfusion. We are confident with the results of the EUFA study showing that polymixing DNA perfusion added to conventional therapy of sepsis significantly improved organ dysfunction and reduced mortality in this target population of patients with severe sepsis or septic shock. In particular, there is a decrease of the renal sulfur score, inducing a kind of protection of the kidney. This is what we investigated in Torino with the Marco Ranieri group, and with the same model in vitro, incubating tubular cells, we can observe that after polymixing DNA perfusion, you have a decrease of the apoptotic signals induced by this plasma. Other approaches may be the selective cytoforative device proposed by David Humes at the University of Michigan. So putting one filtering series in which leukocytes are entrapped in the outer part of the outer membrane filter, and if we use a citrate as anticoagulation, we have a decrease of the inflammatory properties and a better outcome of these animals. We also propose that use of renal access device, putting variable tubular epithelial cells in the second filtering series, so adding the artificial to the artificial glomerulus of the function, the metabolic and probably the immune function of tubular epithelial cells, showing a decrease of a better outcome in patients, and probably tubular epithelial cells may also release some tropic factors to reduce AKA progression and length. And last, the use of tubular cells from the DAOs to the fascinating world of cell therapies, in particular mesenchymal stem cell therapy, that have been exploring in different models and different clinical trials in acute and as well as chronic disease, because mesenchymal stem cells have been demonstrated in experimental models of AKI to reach into the kidney and release parakine factors that induce the regeneration of tubular cells, but mesenchymal an immunoregulatory mechanism because it may induce, may alter, may moderate the systemic inflammation and the immune response, in particular producing T regulatory cells. So, are quite interesting. Mesenchymal stem cells have been exploring in AKI patients in cardiac surgery, also to decrease delayed graft function in kidney transplantation. We have some data in experimental models of sepsis in which mesenchymal stem cell infusion decreases ameliorated renal function, and this is probably due to a better balance of pro-inflammatory and anti-inflammatory cytokines induced by stem cell infusion. So coming to conclusion, I show you that inflammation plays a key role in tubular cell injury during AKI, and in our journey to the physics from entropy to entanglement, tubular cells are immunologically active and may contribute to systemic inflammation. Sepsis represent the main cause of AKI, inducing several functional alterations of tubular epithelial cells. These biological detrimental activities are mainly due to a toxic immunologic mechanism which pens and dams play a key role. We have some more new mixed boson, probably, and potential therapeutic targets, such as microvesicles. And so early inoculate biomarkers, septic AKI, and new therapeutic approaches, such as extracorporeal blood purification, cell therapy, I think may limit in hospital mortality and progression to chronic kidney disease. Coming to the end of our physical journey, inflammation and sepsis, we don't not understand it well enough. Thank you.